Today, a lot of communities spend a lot of time and energy developing plans as well as regulating their development. But we've come to realize there's a fundamental disconnect between our community plans and our development regulations. Hello and welcome to Form-Based Codes 101. I'm Mary Madden, a principal in the urban design and town planning firm Farrell Madden and a founding member of the Form-Based Codes Institute. FBCI is collaborating with Plan Edison on a series of courses providing an overview of form-based codes, developing them, legal issues, examples of way they're used around the country, and methods for preparation. This is in addition to a series of advanced courses that FBCI provides. You can get further information about those courses and the way to receive a certificate for full Form-Based Codes Institute certification. Further information is available in the course materials. In today's course, we are providing an introduction to form-based codes, where we will define what form-based codes are, explain why they were invented, provide examples of how they're being used, as well as some common mistakes and misunderstandings about what form-based codes are and how they're different from conventional zoning. In theory, our zoning ordinances should implement our comprehensive plans, but that is frequently not the case. For example, if you read the statement on the screen, picture in your mind what type of place you think that should be. This is a very common idea that a lot of comprehensive plans emphasize, sort of ideal places like apple pie and motherhood. It's like, what community would not want these things? Perhaps you might have a different stylistic idea, but maybe you thought of a place like this. Mixed use, a place where you can imagine walking, living, shopping, etc. And it really fulfills the statement that you just saw. As a reminder, again, this is from a comprehensive plan, policy goal. And in fact, the previous image was computer generated. This is the real photograph of that place. And if you remember the statement, this is also affordable multifamily housing along a transportation corridor. But it's probably not exactly what this community had in mind. But in fact, this is what their development regulations delivered today. If you think back in history, we used to develop our towns and our communities, our cities. You knew when you were in town and you knew when you were in the countryside. Our towns were inherently mixed use. You could work there, you could live there, you could play, you could worship. There's probably also a school in this photograph. This is the way we built in this country for hundreds of years, centuries. But somehow we lost our way. Today we build places that are really no longer town, no longer city. They're really just what you might describe as no place. And frequently, we end up building places that are really not countryside either. They're houses that used to be rural areas, and we may actually name them after places or things that used to be where the new development is today. And it's no wonder that people are disappointed with the type of development we have. And a lot of people have started recognizing this problem. In fact, even the realtors notice this in one of their recent publications. They identified the fact that people don't like sprawl, but in most cases, our developers, our builders, are actually delivering exactly what our zoning regulations call for. So the question is, how did we get here? What happened? The Form-Based Codes Institute delivers education, research, and outreach on form-based codes and looking at ways we can rethink the way we develop today. The next section of the chapter is going to provide an overview introduction of why communities are using form-based codes and really answer the question, how did we get here and where do we go from here? I'll be joined today by Victor Dover and Tony Perez. Let's get started.